Well, welcome everyone. Thank you for coming. I'd like to remind everyone that this presentation is being recorded and will be available on our website soon. Innovate the Workplace is a series of workshops delivered by engaging local, national, and statewide sought-out speakers and teachers whose trainings ignite employees to implement new and innovative strategies in the areas of employee care, human resources, diversity, equity, inclusion, and community engagement. We focus on enhancing workplace unity, minimizing organizational division, and improving company cultures. Today's workshop is brought to you by ADP and our event sponsor, the Pacific Mountain Workforce Development Council. During the presentation, we encourage you to use the Q&A section during the workshop. We will pause throughout the presentation to answer questions as well as do some informal polling. Right now, I'd like to introduce you to Ty Reed, our presenter. Since entering recovery in 2016, Ty has rebuilt his life and now uses the lessons learned while recovering from homelessness, addiction, and life as a petty criminal to help others. Through his nonprofit, Recovery Career Services, which is dedicated to helping people in recovery find and keep employment, he provides career coaching and developmental to assist individuals in rebuilding their professional lives. Ty also uses public speaking, storytelling workshops, and webinars to communicate his message to those in recovery, their families, and the business community about the importance of desperation, hope, and second chances. Today, he will share with you how to create a win-win situation and how businesses like yours can make a positive impact within the community while improving your bottom line. Ty, take it away.
Thank you so much, Amanda. Thank you for that great introduction, which I totally wrote for you, but I appreciate you using. Good morning, everybody. I'm really happy to be here and talk a bit about a topic that I'm really passionate about, which is second chance employment. So if you'll bear with me for a second, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen here, and I will do my best not to make this a death by PowerPoint moment, but hopefully we'll just be able to bring a few things there. Okay, can everybody see my screen? Awesome. Okay, appreciate it. So the name of our presentation today is The Second Chance Solution and Using Inclusive Practices to Source Talent. The reason why I feel like this is so important will become evident as I kind of go through the presentation here, but really what we have currently are two problems that are kind of the solution to each other. The first problem is that employers are having significant issues, obviously, finding employees due to the conditions of the pandemic. The second problem is that we have a huge pool of talented people who are overlooked and often untapped. So in an effort to bring these two together and solve two problems, I hope that my presentation can provide you some thoughts and to consider some things that perhaps maybe you didn't in the past. So a brief agenda. I'm one of those people, it makes me crazy to go to a meeting without an agenda. So as a coworker, I can sometimes be a nightmare, quite frankly. But we're gonna have a brief introduction. I'll do a definition of what second chance employment is. We'll have some statistics and do a poll. Then I'll talk a bit about some of the benefits, both from a community and employer standpoint to second chance employment, some practices that make this possible, and then some incredibly practical and pretty easy, and more importantly, really free steps that businesses can take to move towards this type of employment. And then if lots of folks will ask me, that's great, Ty, but I'm not a hiring manager. What can I actually do to help in this area? So I'll give you some tips about that as well. And then I'll provide my contact info at the end for anyone that would like to reach out or connect with me. So as an introduction, again, Amanda did a great job, but I'm Ty. What all those letters behind my name mean really is that I've been a very lucky guy in my life. I've been lucky enough to go to the University of Washington a couple of times and graduate. I'm fortunate enough to have a professional and human resources designation. So I have some insight into the ways that human resource managers and hiring managers think. I'm also a certified workforce development professional, which means I spend a lot of time talking to individuals who are trying to get into the workforce or move to a different place in the workforce. And I'm also honored to be a certified peer counselor in Washington State and use my journey of recovery to help other people who may be walking that same path. In my day job, I am a business engagement project manager for Workforce Snohomish, one of the 12 workforce development councils in Washington State. And what that really means is I spend a lot of time talking to employers and hearing the issues that they are facing when it comes to attracting, retaining, and upskilling their talent. And my passion project and the thing that I absolutely love to do and talk about is Recovery Career Services, which, as Amanda said, is a nonprofit dedicated to helping people that are in recovery from addiction, alcoholism, and past criminal justice involvement solve employment problems that are caused by alcoholism, addiction, homelessness, and past criminal justice involvement. And I'm very happy to be able to do that as well. I always like to take a little bit of a poll before. So we're going to have a more formal poll in a little bit, but this is really something that talks a bit more about the impressions that we have. And we all have these images that come to mind, but when you think of a homeless person, what's the image that kind of comes to mind? And when you think about someone who may be a drug addict, what is the image that comes to mind? And finally, when you think about a person with a criminal record, what do you think about? And there are no right or wrong answers to this, but I really use this as more of an example of how our preconceived notions about certain groups of people can color the way that we might interact with them when we come in contact with them. And again, there's no right or wrong answer to any of these, but what I will tell you is that if your images did not include me, then you don't really have a full picture of kind of what was going on. Because as Amanda said, for a period in my life, quite frankly, I was a homeless meth addict and an alcoholic living on the streets of Seattle, completely unemployable and in and out of jail. And when I look at these pictures, the first thing I think is, man, I look horrible in green. That's the first thing. But the second thing that I think is that, you know, I feel really lucky to have come through that period in my life. But this period in my life was really the inspiration for what I do now, because what I found when I entered recovery in 2016, that despite having an MBA from the University of Washington and having over 12 years of really strong sales and business development experience in the corporate world, the first job I was able to get was part-time as a janitor. Now, don't get me wrong, that's an honorable job and that's a necessary job. But I reasoned that if somebody as lucky as me, who had the type of background I have, would have such difficulty finding quality and meaningful work, then what must it be like for someone who's not as lucky as me? And by the way, I didn't get that janitor job because it was the only one I applied for. It was just the first one that would take me. Although I applied to many jobs that, in my criminal convictions, all misdemeanors, by the way, had nothing to do with the positions that I was applying for. So as I moved further in my recovery and started thinking about ways that I could give back to other folks who may be kind of walking that same path, I kept coming back to employment. And that was the inspiration for my nonprofit, Recovery Career Services. So Spider-Man just came out. So I was thinking about how am I like Spider-Man? And I was always attracted to Spider-Man when I was a kid because I was kind of a nerdy teen. And Spider-Man at his heart was a really nerdy teen. He didn't really fit in. And so this thought about not fitting in necessarily and having this power, this strength that people didn't know about really appealed to me. I also look really great in red and blue. So I'm horrible in green, but I look pretty good in red and blue. And really the last thing is that my origin story, what I just talked about, it defines my work. And Spider-Man's origin story, when Uncle Ben, if you read the comic books, or Aunt May, if you just saw the movie, was dying and said to him, with great power comes great responsibility. I really feel like that I have a responsibility because of the path that I've walked and some of the doors that are open to me to talk about the importance of second chance employment and providing opportunity for folks who are on the comeback trail. So let's talk a bit about what second chance employment actually is. And the Society for Human Resource Management, or SHRM, as it's more popularly known, has a really great definition, which says that second chance employment is the act of employing formerly incarcerated individuals, people in recovery, or other applicants whose choices and situations have disadvantaged them in obtaining stable employment. So this is a great kind of catch-all definition of what second chance employment is. But to me, second chance employment is also about a few other things. It is about comebacks and the best parts of us. And I love talking about comeback stories for a couple of reasons. Number one, everybody loves a comeback story. And there are so many things in our country today that divide us. Sometimes we divide ourselves by choice. Sometimes we are divided by others. But just about everybody, no matter what your background, no matter what your economic situation, no matter what your political affiliation or your race or your gender, people can get behind a comeback story. And I call them the best parts of us for a couple of reasons. Number one, the person who's actually making the comeback has to demonstrate some things. They've got to demonstrate some resilience and some perseverance and humility. And they need to be willing to overcome obstacles. And they need to be able to ask for help, because nobody does a comeback alone. And for those folks that they encounter along the way, because in every comeback story, there's always that person or that group of people that come along to help someone at just the right time. It seems like magic, but it somehow always happens. It allows those folks to show compassion and forgiveness and the willingness to help someone who is helping themselves. So it really does show all the best parts of humanity. And again, forgiveness and compassion, which are needed these days. The other thing is, second chance employment is about fairness. It's, to me, the type of society that I want to live in is one that once someone has paid their debt to the justice system and to society by fulfilling whatever their legal obligation is, if it's, you know, being incarcerated, if it is paying a fine, if it's doing community service, that person should not then be sentenced further to a financial sentence that prevents them from becoming regular taxpaying members of society. But so often that is what happens. And it's also about a fair exchange of value. And for employers who might see this, I can't stress this more importantly, more strongly. This is an exchange of value. You're going to get an employee who is going to bring their enthusiasm and their skills and their background to your organization. And in exchange, they're going to get some stuff too. They're going to get benefits. They're going to get money in the form of compensation. And they're also going to get the opportunity to maybe grow their skills and advance within the company. But this is not a handout. This is not you sacrificing your business. It is an equal exchange of value, no different than any other exchange that you would make when you hire an employee, whether they have a criminal justice background or not. And what it's absolutely not about, as I just kind of touched on a bit, is not about sacrificing profit to feel good. I would be the last person who would ever tell an employer that they should sacrifice the profit or the quality of their workforce just to get the warm and fuzzies and hire somebody. You don't have to do that. It also is not about charity and handouts. It is about providing a fair and equal opportunity for someone if they are qualified for the position. It's not about taking somebody who's not qualified. It's not about creating a space for them just because you think it's the right thing to do. It is about people that are trying to do the right thing and build their life in a different way and giving them the opportunity to do that. And it's also not about crafting policies that favor those with criminal records. That's not equality either, because now you're sacrificing the quality of your company, perhaps, and preventing an opportunity from someone who, you know, may be more qualified for the position. So when I talk about the solution, the second chance solution is the name of this presentation, what am I talking about? It's that thing I referred to earlier. This is really the convergence of two issues that are joined by need, made more urgent by circumstance, and pretty easily solved by a shift in perspective. And that shift in perspective is the biggest part here. And the shift in perspective shows up in a number of different ways. By the way, if anybody has any questions or comments, feel free to drop them in the chat. Amanda is monitoring the chat for me because I can't see it when I'm sharing my screen. But if you have any questions or see any Amanda, feel free to just kind of jump in and stop me. All right. So the shift in perspective that's necessary, it's moving from an us and them perspective to a we perspective. So often, hiring managers and employers who have not been involved in the criminal justice system don't see themselves as similar to people who may have been involved in the criminal justice system. And it's very easy to do that. Again, our society in many ways has trained us to be in an us versus them mentality, but we need a shift in perspective to come to a we mentality. We can solve these problems together, not when we stand as us versus them. It also comes, you know, putting aside some of our personal baggage. And we've all got baggage. Sometimes it's a steamer trunk And sometimes it's a little clutch that we carry with us, but we all have baggage of some sort, right? So putting aside, again, it gets back to those preconceived notions that I talked about before. The views that we may have about what someone who has been in one of these situations, homelessness, addiction, criminal justice involvement, putting aside whatever thoughts that we may have about that and really giving them an opportunity to prove themselves to us. It also is going to require a moving away from we've always done it this way. And I hear this so often from employers. Well, we've never hired folks that have criminal records before. And that's just the way we've always done it. And it really requires a willingness to think about doing it in a different way. And recognizing, and this is kind of my favorite one, recognizing that often luck is the biggest factor that determines whether you end up with a criminal record or not. And I love using this example because people, you know, almost everybody in the room can relate to this. So I'm gonna ask just a series of questions here. You don't have to raise your hands. I'm not going to ask you to out yourself, but just kind of think about this. Anybody here ever had a little too much to drink and gotten behind the wheel and driven home? Well, if that's the case, you're pretty lucky you didn't end up with a felony DUI or something worse and hurt somebody. Anyone here ever been involved in a physical altercation with another person, even if it was just a shoving match? Well, if that's the case, you're kind of lucky you didn't end up with an assault charge or something worse. And finally, before weed was legal, anybody here ever smoke a little weed or have any weed in their possession or something a little stronger maybe, or anybody ever drink when they were underage perhaps? Well, if that's the case, you're lucky you didn't end up with a possession charge that may have ended up influencing negatively your employment. So luck and often location, meaning if you live in a neighborhood that is more heavily policed, and you have more run-ins with law enforcement, the likelihood of you being involved in the criminal justice system goes up greatly. Luck and location are major factors in whether people end up with criminal records and whether they don't. And so just that recognition, that shift in perspective can often make a big difference in how people view these things. Okay, so we're gonna talk a bit about how the US criminal justice problem, and then we're gonna go into a series of polls here. So there's a big criminal justice problem in the United States. According to the FBI and the Department of Justice, somewhere between 70 and 78 million adults in the United States have a criminal record. To put that into perspective, that's 1 in 3 adults, and that's more people than have bachelor's degrees. So that just kind of gives you an idea of the scope of the problem. In Washington State, there's about 2 million people that have a criminal record. That's according to the Washington State Patrol. And about 90% of those people, by the way, have absolutely no current involvement with the criminal justice system. And what do I mean by that? What I mean is they're not on probation, they're not on parole, they're not actually incarcerated right now, they're not doing community service, and they're not making restitution to the court. So what that means is there's a huge population of individuals that are just dragging around their criminal records with them, even though they're no longer involved with the criminal justice system, and they're being caused opportunities in education and in housing and in employment. So there's a big pool of people available that really need opportunities given to them in a fair manner. About 600,000 people are released from prison, that's state and federal prisons annually, that's according to the Department of Justice. And then also according to the Department of Justice, about another 9 million people cycle through local jails every single year. So we've talked a little bit about the criminal justice issue. And the United States also, if no one knew this, has the highest incarceration rate by far in the world. It's not even close, quite frankly. So let's go into some poll questions. Amanda, do you have those to pull up? Do I need to stop sharing for you to do that? I don't, that's awesome. All right, so let's go with question number one. And just your best guess here. What percentage of formerly incarcerated people will be unemployed 1 year after release? All right, I know the number. I know what that number is. The question is, do you? The second question, pre-pandemic, the unemployment rate for the general population was 4%. What was the unemployment rate for people with criminal convictions? And then the last one is, more than 2/3 of prisoners are arrested within 3 years, rearrested within 3 years. What do you think is the number one cause of recidivism? Recidivism is reoffense and being put back into the system. What do you think the number one cause of that is? Amanda, are we getting submissions?
We are, yes.
Awesome. Okay. So the answer to number one is 75%. So a full 3 out of 4 people 1 year after they leave the criminal justice system are unemployed. For number two, the answer is 27%. So almost 7 times the national rate of unemployment, folks who have a criminal conviction are unemployed as well. And then finally, the number one reason why people go back to jail or prison is poverty. And this last one kind of makes sense, right? So there are some financial realities that people have. Got to eat, got to have a place to live, need to have transportation somewhere, even if that's taking the bus or public transit of some sort. And I truly believe that if people are given an opportunity to make an honest living, they will. But if they're not, unfortunately, a lot of folks are going to fall back on some of the habits they may have had before. And this is a very crude way to put it, but a parole officer I was talking to put it this way, and I think he's right. We basically have a choice. Do we want people showing up at a job site or workplace to get a paycheck, or do we want them showing up at your house to get your stereo? Again, a very crude way to put it, but if folks are not given an opportunity to make a living wage and an honest living, then unfortunately, those are the types of issues that we're going to have. All right. There are a number. I want to pause for a second. Any questions there before I move on to the next thing? All right. I must be doing a great job. All right. So the employer benefits and of second chance hiring, and there are many of them. Number one, you get access to a really deep talent pool. And this, again, that number I quoted earlier, about 70 million people in this country have a criminal record. 70 million adults, I should say, have a criminal record of some sort. And about 2 million of those are in Washington State. And unfortunately, not every employer is gonna be open to employing this group of people. And there's gonna be a wide array of talent. They're gonna be people that are, their experience sets them up to be entry-level employees at your company. So there's opportunities, and that those typically are the opportunities that employers say they're having the hardest time filling, or those more entry-level roles. You're gonna have some individuals like that. You're gonna have some individuals like me who were clicking right along in life, actually have some education, have some job skills, and for whatever reason, their lives got off track. They hit a speed bump or they ran into a pothole or a ditch in my case. Right? And they're putting their lives back together. They're on the right track now, but you're going to have access to a talent pool and a lot less competition, quite frankly, again, because just not every employer is going to be open to providing opportunity. This is also a really easy way to address any diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives that your company may have. And there's a really specific reason for that. It has been pretty well documented that communities of color have been disproportionately impacted by involvement with the criminal justice system, mainly and mostly incarceration. So if you have any initiatives around DEI, by saying that you're gonna offer employment opportunities for people who have past criminal justice involvement, you're almost automatically saying that you're gonna be open to hiring a more diverse group of individuals. So it's a very easy way to address those initiatives. And oh, by the way, diversity of background is also a type of diversity that should seriously be thought about. Because when people think about diversity, they typically jump right to race and gender. Those are the big two, right? But diversity of background is another valuable perspective to bring into your workforce. And to the best of your ability to have employees that can bring that should be one of your aims. At least that's what I argue. One of the other great benefits is stronger community. And this goes a little bit back to that last poll question about what makes folks reoffend and go back into the system. So second chance employment helps with stronger communities in this way. It has been shown in multiple studies that for communities that have higher employment rates or lower unemployment rates, however you want to phrase that, have lower poverty, lower crime, lower homelessness, and a greater tax base from which to draw to fund programs and services for the community. And as an employer, obviously, if you're in a community that is getting that additional tax base and those services and seeing all those lowered rates of homelessness, poverty, and unemployment, then you're gonna benefit as well. It's kind of that a rising tide raises all boats thing. So employers have a role to play in directly in helping their communities improve and become stronger. And then the final thing is, this is a big one. You kind of get some loyal employees out of it. There's a study that was commissioned by SHRM, and I believe it was the Cook Institute, 2020. And what it looked at was the turnover rates of employees who have past criminal justice involvement versus those who don't. And it found that those employees who had criminal records, frankly, they stayed around longer, about 13% longer, which is a direct translation of savings for an employer. And there's a couple of reasons for that. One, which is pretty good, and one, which is not that great, but it's still true. Number one, if you've been denied opportunity after opportunity and somebody gives you a shot, you're probably going to be kind of loyal to that person. And you're probably, or that company, and you're going to want to prove some things because you have some things to prove to yourself, but you don't want to make them look stupid. So you're going to get a loyal employee because of that. And the other reason is not a great reason, but still employers can benefit from it. Those employees simply may have fewer options because, again, fewer employers are going to be open to hiring folks that have past criminal justice involvement. So whether they stay because they love you, but because they can't go anywhere else, the truth is they stay longer, which is a benefit to the employer. All right, so there's a couple of practices that I'm going to talk about that kind of make this possible. And then I'm going to give some very practical steps that employers can take to have more inclusive hiring practices. So the first practice that makes this possible is hiring the best candidate regardless of criminal history. So you see the candidate's resume, they look great. They come in an interview and you love them. You want to offer them the job. You make an offer, you do a background check. So effectively, you've already said yes, pending that criminal background check. And then the background comes back. The magic here is if they're actually the best candidate, even if they have a criminal history, you stay saying yes. So, and if you have a policy that says we're going to hire the best candidate regardless, then that is going to go a long way. The second thing is you need to craft policies that are open and accept the best applicants. And you can only accept the best applicants if you have policies and steps in place that attract the greatest number of applicants who might actually be qualified. And I'm going to talk about that in just a second. So there's some very practical, low-risk, easy steps that employers can take to have these more inclusive hiring practices and widen the pool of applicants that they'll have coming to them. So the number one is avoiding blanket policies regarding criminal history. One of the experiences that I've had, and I've had a number of my clients tell me about this as well, is they go through an interview process, they do really well, an offer is made, the criminal background check comes back, and then the employer will say to them, you know, we really, really like you, but we can't hire you right now because your criminal history. Come back and apply with us in another 5 years. I've had clients say that. I had an employer tell me, come back in 7 years, actually, because they had these blanket policies regarding criminal history. Now, it's bad for a couple of reasons. Number one, obviously, you are, as an employer, you're severely limiting the pool of applicants the pool of applicants that will be interested in your company and that you will give opportunity to. The second thing is that you might be setting yourself up for a lawsuit because, as I talked about a little earlier, communities of color have been disproportionately impacted by the criminal justice system. So if you have a policy that says that you won't take anyone that has criminal convictions, misdemeanor, or felony for a certain period of time, if somebody wanted to get aggressive with that policy, they could say that it's a disparate treatment policy. You're treating different races differently than other races. So it's something to watch out for. The other thing is you can add one sentence to your equal employment opportunity policy. So, you know, virtually every employer out there has a policy that says that we do not discriminate in employment when it comes to race, color, creed, national origin, gender, sexual identity, things like that. But if they were also add, you know, a sentence or a phrase that said, we also do not discriminate when it comes to irrelevant criminal history in employment, that is a signal both to applicants that they may be given a fair shot if the position that they're applying for has nothing to do with the criminal convictions that they have. It's also going to be a signal to your workforce, because I assure you that there are people that are working for your company right now who know people that have criminal convictions and are looking for a job. And every employer always wants employee referrals as far as the applicants that they interview, because those tend to be the best. And so that, just adding this phrase to your EEO policy will signal to applicants and to current employees that you have more inclusive hiring practices and will broaden the type of applicants and number of applicants that you'll get to see. You can also use less restrictive language in job postings. I mentioned that I do some work around workforce development in Snohomish County. And one of the things that I find really frustrating when I talk to employers is they want to put up job postings, and it's an entry level position, but they'll say that somebody has to have 5 years of experience, which makes absolutely no sense, right? But so it's bad for a couple of reasons. It hurts the employer and it hurts the potential applicant. It hurts the employer because there's going to be a number of people who look at that ad, and if they don't have 5 years experience, they're just not going to apply. The other thing is, especially if the employer is using an applicant tracking system that helps to filter out resumes, even if someone applies, if the applicant tracking system is set to say that they have to have 5 years experience, those resumes are going to get kicked out right away and the employer will never see them. And so it really is, that language is really limiting opportunity on both sides. So what I try to encourage employers to do is really look at what is necessary in this position. Is it really necessary that somebody has 5 years of experience to work on a loading dock? Probably not. You know, be realistic about what is required in those positions. But what that means that employers have to do is they have to get really intentional about writing their job postings and reviewing each position to see what is absolutely necessary and what is a nice to have. But it's a fairly easy thing to do in the sense that it's free and there isn't, you know, there, you don't have to get a lawyer involved. You can really just look at those job postings and decide what language is necessary and what is not. I also encourage employers to review every single position in the company for a couple of reasons. It probably doesn't make a lot of sense for the background check for your accountant position to be the same as your background check for your, you know, inventory position for the person that works in a warehouse, just using that as an example. That probably doesn't make a lot of sense. Now, obviously, in some situations, you certainly want to have criminal background checks, and those are practical to do. But I would argue that, you know, perhaps if you were to look at all your positions, you're going to find positions where you can offer someone who may have past criminal justice involvement an opportunity, either by lowering the background check requirement or just removing it altogether. Because again, there's no law that says that every position has to have the same requirement. So this just requires that an employer actually look at each position with a critical eye and think about whether it makes sense or not. But by taking those more entry-level positions and lowering those requirements, again, you can provide an opportunity for someone who needs it. And I assure you, there are lots of people who need it. I talk to clients every single day that are having issues in finding employment because of past criminal justice involvement. Also encourage employers to use what's called the nature, time, nature test. And what this refers to, and these slides are gonna be available to everyone afterwards. We'll make sure that these come out. But you wanna use the nature, time, nature test. And what this means is when you're talking to an applicant or considering an applicant, you look and you run the background check and they have a background. You want to look at the nature of the crime, the time since that conviction occurred, and the nature of the job that they're applying for. And I'll give you a very simple example. If you're hiring somebody to be a delivery driver for your company, probably doesn't make a lot of sense to hire somebody that had a DUI last year. It just doesn't. But if you're hiring for a position in your company and let's say it's a sales position, and someone had a drug possession charge 2 years ago, well, maybe that makes sense. I'm not saying that you should definitely hire them, but what I'm saying is you should give them consideration, especially when you look at the nature of the crime, the time since it elapsed, and the nature of the position that they're applying for. And the last thing, and this may be the most important thing, get curious. And what I mean by this is it's interesting how just by asking a couple of simple questions, we can learn some things that may change our perspective. So when I talk to employers, I encourage them, when you get that person who they have a criminal background, just ask them some questions. Ask them to give you some details about what happened with this particular criminal conviction. And even more importantly, ask them what's been going on in their lives since that happened. And that's really the most important part, because I would argue if you have somebody that had even a very serious criminal conviction 5 years ago, when I say serious, you know, a felony of some sort, but you ask them what's been going on in their lives since then, and they say, well, you know, I have entered a 12-step program. I've become a member of my church. I've done community service. I have worked at this. I worked as a volunteer doing this, and I've got this letter of recommendation from my supervisor at that. I would say that if they have the other qualifications for the position, that might be somebody you should seriously consider. But unless you get curious about them and take the extra step of asking questions as opposed to simply seeing that they have criminal convictions and dismissing them right away, you're never going to know whether you have a good candidate. So by simply providing them an opportunity to give you some context and getting kind of curious, you can perhaps find somebody that's going to bring tremendous value to your organization. So yeah, I had somebody, I typically do these presentations for businesses, you know, managers and HR people, but I had someone come up to me not that long ago and say, you know, Ty, the incredible power of your persuasion and charisma have convinced me that, and modesty, have convinced me that this, you know, second chance employment is really important, but I'm not a hiring manager. So, you know, what can I do to help folks that might be in this situation? And there's a few things. Number one, you can advocate. And when I say advocate, I don't necessarily mean going to, you know, the Capitol and standing on the steps in Olympia with a picket sign. I don't mean that, although that would be fine if you did that too. But what I really mean is if you know someone in your life, and it is likely that you probably do know someone who is in recovery or has past criminal justice involvement or both, or was once homeless. If you know someone in your life who is seeking an employment opportunity and you're pretty sure that they're actually doing things the right way, they're living their lives in a way that demonstrates that they're trying to be a different person than they were before when whatever criminal transgression happened, then advocate on their behalf to the best of your ability. If there's a position that's open at your company, you know, talk to the HR manager, talk to the manager of that position and see if you can make a referral and do whatever you can, of course, without putting your own position in jeopardy, to be a champion for this person to help give it an opportunity, whether it's at your company or if it's making a referral to another company. That's a very powerful thing because often folks that are walking this journey and making that comeback, they kind of feel powerless in some cases. They often don't have strong networks of people that they can lean upon to help them in their search. And so anything that you can do as an individual to assist would be greatly appreciated and incredibly impactful. If your management ever asks you, what is important to you or what things you would like to see your company do, tell them, I would love to see us offer second chance employment opportunities to folks that have past criminal justice involvement. And if they ask you why, then hopefully I've given you a couple of things that you could say to them about why it's important today. But make your voice heard when they ask you about it. And quite often these days, companies do ask for their employer's feedback. You can volunteer. There are a number of organizations, I'm going to list a few of them here at the end, that are focused on reentry, or at least where you can go to get reentry services is what they call the process of helping people transition from incarceration back into society and become citizens again. There's organizations you can volunteer for that are always looking for people to help with things like resume prep and mock interviewing, and really just helping folks get back on the path to being self-sufficient again. Also, inspect your biases. This kind of goes back to that early conversation we had. We all have, things that impact the way that we interact with individuals. My girlfriend is a vegan. I don't understand how anyone could be vegan. I have a bias, but I put that aside I make sure that I put those to the side whenever we're having a meal together. So inspect your biases and to the degree that you can try to put those aside when you encounter someone. And then, get curious about folks. Try to the best of your ability. Don't just jump to conclusions. I know that we human beings, we use shortcuts in many ways to simplify the world. If I see a tiger approaching me, I'm not going to go up to the tiger and ask any questions. Hey, are you here to eat me? I'm going to run the other way, right? But, there are so many situations where if we just take a few minutes to ask for additional information, often we will see people in situations in a different light. All right, and so there's some of the resources. There's Washington State Reentry Info. There's a reentry program for incarcerated veterans. There's the link to the website. There is the Washington Statewide Reentry Council, which is run out of the Department of Commerce. And then there are some, these are statewide agencies or programs. There's also, and I apologize that many of these are, some of these are actually up in King, Snohomish, and Pierce County, where I am more. So Pioneer Human Services, Orion Industries, both of those do worker retraining, and provide employment opportunities for individuals who have previously been incarcerated to get them ready to go out into the workforce. Goodwill Industries is statewide, and Goodwill does all kinds of workforce development and worker retraining for folks who have past criminal justice involvement. And of course, you can Google reentry services or worker retraining to find something in your area. I think I might have one more slide. I do. There's some other organizations that provide support for individuals who have past criminal justice involvement. Defy Ventures actually works with individuals while they're in prison. And then when they exit prison, they set them up on a, or they get them involved in an entrepreneurship program. So not every person wants to work for somebody else. Some people want to work for themselves, and Defy Ventures helps individuals discover whether that is for them and give them some education around how to best do that. The Workforce Foundation, they do similar work to Defy, except it's all around employment. So they work within, they place individuals who were previously criminal justice involved in actual work roles. Uplift Northwest is, they actually help homeless folks and put them, they're actually a staffing agency that puts homeless folks to work. People who are escaping homelessness or were previously homeless. And then What's Next Washington is an advocacy and lobbying organization that has a full range of programs available, mainly aimed at employers to help employers understand the importance of second chance employment. They do fantastic work. Could not recommend them any more highly. And so I encourage you to take a look at all these organizations. So in summary, second chance employment is about fairness and opportunity. It offers employers a talent pool with much less competition. Employers really should adjust hiring practices to try to be more inclusive as opposed to more exclusive. And second chance hiring has benefits for businesses, communities, and individuals, and you can help in a variety of ways, like by advocating, speaking out, and inspecting your beliefs and your biases. Here's my contact info. I encourage everyone to connect with me on LinkedIn, or feel free to go to my website. I have a number of resources there on my resource page. Of course, we're a 501c3 registered nonprofit. We'll take your money too. Every penny that we get goes towards providing services for individuals, two groups. Number one, individuals who are coming back from addiction, homelessness, and past criminal justice involvement and trying to get back into the workforce. The other group of individuals that we help are working professionals whose careers are in jeopardy because of their alcohol and drug use. I work with them individually to help them figure out how to save their job and give them back the power of choice instead of being escorted out by security with their stuff in a box. So those are the two groups that I work with. Again, feel free to check out the website. Any questions that folks have?
We do have a question. Yeah. We were talking earlier about employers getting curious. And are there questions you can or cannot legally ask?
Yeah, always. So there's the questions that I always always encourage employers to ask are open-ended and really generic. If you run a background check and somebody had a criminal conviction, tell me about the circumstances surrounding this thing that happened in your background, and then just let them talk. And then when it comes to asking them about what their life is, you know, what activities or what life they've been living since that happened, you know, what's been going on in your life since this occurred? And then just let them talk and then fill in the blanks. And those two things should give you enough information to either A, decide if you need to ask a couple more questions or get more detail, right? Or B, if this is not somebody you should consider. I'm certainly not naive enough to think that every person that has a criminal conviction is gonna be a right fit for your company, because they won't. But what I'm asking people to do is to be open-minded and curious enough to ask the questions and see if they might be.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Well, in closing, I want to thank you all for attending today. And thank you again, Tyree, as well as ADP and the Pacific Mountain Workforce Development Council for making this webinar possible. We will get a copy of this presentation out to everybody who attended, and as well as Ty's contact information. And I hope you all have a wonderful afternoon, and hopefully see you at our next Innovate.
Thank you very much. Well done.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Ty.
Thank you.